welcome to this talk. In this talk, I will try to show what's the day-to-day agenda of a security engineer, how the security team works in the internally, and how can we do it better if developers and security engineers collaborate. Just a small introduction. So my name is Adam. I have been a senior security engineer inside the Adevinta security team for more than 2 years. I have more than a decade of system and network engineering experience, and my security has always been present inside this experience. I consider myself to be a technology enthusiast because I like technology in general, because over the span of my life I have seen how it evolved, and it's very interesting to see the future. And I'm also a huge Python fan and evangelist because I consider it to be one of the best languages out there, and I use it all for all my projects. I also helped to co-found and co-organize PyCon 2000 and SK, and looking at it 3 years later, I am very happy to see how nice, big and interesting this event was. So for this reason, I would like to ask applause for the organizers. And in my spare time, I also organize Barcelona Software-Defined Network and Network Programmability Meetup in Barcelona with my friends. So, you might be asking, what's Adevinta? Adevinta defines itself as a global company that groups some of the world's leading sites. It's present in 16 countries, among Spain, France, Italy, Brazil, and Mexico. The everyday mission is to help people find a new job, a new house, new car, or give every item a second purpose. People from Slovakia can think of it like Profesia, like portals for specific domains. We serve nearly 800 million people, and our sites are visited approximately 1.5 billion times per month. And Adevinta has close to 7,000 employees, and out of those, 2,000 are responsible for the engineering. These are examples of some of our brands. People who are from Austria, for example, they might be familiar with Willhaben. People from Hungary, like Hasnalt Auto or Jofogás. In Italy, it's Subito. In France, very popular is Lebonkova. And in Spain, InfoJobs, Fotocasa, Habitacla, and so on. Given the size and scope of the Adevinta, most teams in Adevinta operate under the philosophy, you build it, you run it. This philosophy originated in 2006 in Amazon, and the idea is that traditionally, the development and operations are separate. This is not true under this philosophy. What does this philosophy do actually is that all the operations and day-to-day tasks are brought to developers. So basically they are always responsible for everything that's related to their application. This is also very crucial for making developers have a day-to-day contact with the customer, as well as this feedback loop is very important for the continuously improving the service quality. If you are interested about examples of how to build such service, there was an excellent talk by my colleague Daniel Cabero One critical thing is that the development and operations are not separate. Basically means that there is no separate DevOps operations or support teams, and everything is done by the developer. If anyone is interested in how we build services, then you might go and check one of these two talks. They were given by my colleague Daniel Cabero. We worked for more than a year in a team. I was embedded as a security engineer, and Daniel is a DevOps engineer. Apart from being embedded, I am also a member of the Adevinta security team, as I mentioned, and we as a security team, we do not consider security to be a blocker. We try to we work internally as another development team, but focusing on problems and solutions for people which they have, which they do have with security related issues. Our motto, protect to enable at scale, reflects our philosophy. Internally, we are divided into three sub-teams, the purple, the blue, and the red. The purple is a team which is responsible for development of security tooling and continuous security. Think of it like DevOps for security. The red is everything related to the offensive security. That means pen testing, attacking the applications, the infrastructure, doing the recon, and so on. And the scope of the blue team is the defensive security, incident response, and threat detection. I'm also a member of the security on-call, and a lot of this experience was actually gained through security incidents. Our daily agenda is basically very similar to yours, and these are some of our projects. So Vulkan, we developed a product called Vulkan, which is a security scanner and orchestrator. It allows us to run in custom in-house checks, which we are writing for specific incidents or specific cases, and as well as orchestrate another security scanners like Nessus, OpenVAS, and so on. In Adavinta, we are heavy users of containers, and scanning them for security vulnerabilities on a regular basis is essential. For this reason, we created Aviso. Every team needs to provide access to their users, and this access needs to be granted in an easy and secure way. For this reason, we developed Heimdall, which is something we call an access user access gateway. But in principle, it is very similar to BeyondCorp from Google. However, we modified it slightly, which fits better our needs. Last but not least is a software called Strombox. Strombox is a project we use internally for securely storing secrets in AWS. We open sourced it in 2017. On top of products, we also provide services. Service like security advisory. This service is basically meant for people to have a way how to ask us non-urgent issues. So in this case, we are basically helping them with. Their requests or questions, helping them during the design or trying to respond to any security-related questions they have. Slightly more modified version of security advisory is security incident advisory. This is basically an active security on-call, and this is basically the security incident response. What we actually do here is that we are trying to help people during the incidents when there are security-related problems, and we are cooperating side by side with them. And a security team without the ethical hacking or pen testing would not be a security team, and I'm pretty sure that everybody thinks that security team is only about hacking, and we are basically doing pen testing or internal application on a regular basis. Another critical service we do is security newsletter. Security newsletter is basically our write-ups and blogs about security topics. We try to do some knowledge sharing, and in this way we are trying to raise the security awareness. Apart from adopting you build it, you run it, we also adopted a slightly modified variant of this motto, which is you build it, we ruin it. This is basically to showcase the mindset of us as a security people, and this term was coined by somebody of my colleagues. Honestly, I do not remember who exactly it was, but it's nice. When I was looking how to summarize our approach to security, I came across a picture, and I think that the new way, which is depicted on the right side, is the best was the closest what we actually do. What we do is that we try to do a proper and good risk analysis. Based on that, we get priorities. Everything when it comes to incidents, when it comes to problems, is handled in a transparent and collaborative way. This is extremely important because our approach, being transparent on security, is very important, and there was certain cases that are now part of the law, and I will talk about that in upcoming slides. When things go wrong and we fix them, we always try to learn from our mistakes and make sure that things do not happen again. This is something that is happening almost through incidents. And we also believe that security is a business enabler, because if things are done properly, you can earn customers' trust. And when customers trust in a business, they are happy and they tend to spend more money with the business. Finally, we also believe that teams should be independent and free. But freedom has its price. If teams are free, they can actually move faster, which is also actually good for business. But freedom brings responsibility. And this means that security is a shared responsibility by everybody who is contributing to the overall product. That means developers, DevOps people, data analysts, system engineers, basically every engineering profile out there that works in shipping the product to the end customer. And this is even more important because in the last May, there were certain things that changed. So I will now do a short survey. I will be interested in just raise your hand. How many of you are actually developers? Oh, quite a few. What about the other profiles like DevOps people, system engineers, data analysts, and so on? Good. How many of you are actually security engineers or another security profile? Okay, there is zero. How many of you developers and other profiles, how many of you actually process private or otherwise sensitive data in your applications? How many of you have dealt with security in any way in the past 12 months? By security, I mean deploying a TLS certificate, designing a system for authentication, and these password policies and these kind of things. Yeah, far more hands up. And how many of you have actually dealt with the security incident in the past 12 months? Good. So now let's do some time traveling 1 year ago. And during the months leading to May, you could have seen more of this. Do you remember it? If so, raise your hands. Yeah. What was happening was that the sites all over the globe were preparing and updating their privacy policies to comply with the new regulation that was created by the European Union. This regulation is called GDPR. Basically, it's a shortcut of General Data Protection Regulation. GDPR applies to EU citizens all over the globe, and the idea is that if any company who processes data of EU citizens, they need to comply with this regulation. And it has been in effect since 25th of May 2018. I will go quickly through GDPR just to give some baseline. So basically what GDPR says that security is the responsibility of the data processor, which in this case is a company or a service provider. They have to be transparent how they are handling the data, what type of data, and who they share it with. If there is a data breach, the companies have 70, if there is data breach and the private, and it's expected that the private data might have been leaked, then these companies have 72 hours to report it to appropriate authorities and also explain and notify user what's happening in a way that the user understands what was going on. GDPR recommends encryption and also recommends something called pseudonymization. Basically, pseudonymization is a form of a data processing. is a form of a data processing in a way that unidentifies the specific users. Meaning that if we have a, we are storing some information about the user, those data should be pseudonymized. So basically, they should not reveal the identity of the specific user. Another thing is that people who only people who are supposed to have access to the data should have it. That means that let's say that somebody is working on a marketing and you as a developer are working with the private data, you too should not have the same level of access to the data, and this can be done by the proper policies put in place. And new role called data privacy officer was created, which basically mandates that any company over 250 employees, or companies that deal with data, or in which are sensitive like medical records, need to appoint a DPO. DPO basically has a free responsibilities. He needs to make sure that the company complies with the law. Another is that he needs to give a study and basically educate people regarding the compliance. And he conducts audits on a regular basis and he fixes issues proactively. Most visible thing in GDPR for the user is the data transparency. Basically, any data which is being collected is subject to the user consent. I'm pretty sure that you have seen on many sites when you visit that they are asking you if you are okay with providing your data, and they are explicitly naming what type of data, how they are going to process it, and how they are sharing it. This is basically the clear statement on what data and how it's being processed. As a user, you also gain a few rights. One of them is a takeout. Basically, if you ask the company to give you all the data they have about you, they should give you it in some time. And normally this can take a while, but it's not normally done automatically. What can also happen is that you can actually import this data to the competition, for example, and you can migrate your data between services. When it comes to erasure, this is actually a big thing because it actually gives you a right, actually a the right, or when you request your data to be deleted, the data has to be deleted. Period. They have to deal with it. However, there are certain limitations. For example, if the data you request to delete deletion of the data, there will be a conflict with the compliance of a different legal obligation, then they can reject doing so. This basically originated from the earlier right to be forgotten, which was a case ruled by European Court of Justice, and it was basically coming from Spain because some guy wanted to delete the data about himself, and he basically got it. Okay, what happens if you do not comply with the GDPR? Everybody has heard about fines, and fines, as defined in the law, are 4% of the global income. So basically, for example, if a big company has a very complicated structure, but the company is not having any profit, then this is basically protected in a way that we are talking about global revenue or 20 million euros, whichever is higher. However, another critical point is that GDPR gives a responsibility for the security to the companies. And if they fail to comply with the law, a natural thing that can happen is that they will lose trustworthiness as a company. If they lose trustworthiness, this can lead to users leaving, and with users gone, the business is dead, basically. Okay, maybe you ask why you should care. It is actually a good question. The reason you should care, because it is about all of us who are producing code, shipping products, services to the users, and GDPR is basically part of the everyday life in many aspects. And also because it is about you, the developers, because you as a developers are being in the center of the industry, because more and more things are being moved to software. And it is many products are actually crucial for modern society, and developers are actually one of the most lucrative jobs as well as most demanded in the job market. I do not know if I have persuaded you, but you might be wondering how you can help. It's actually very simple. I basically, from my experience, I came across five different areas, I would call it that way. One of them is better mutual understanding, better collaboration between you and security people, proper incident handling, fixing low-hanging fruit issues, and code dependency vulnerabilities. When it comes to mutual understanding, basically it's a cliche, I know, I am aware of that, but it is actually a very good exercise if you can put yourself into the shoes of the security engineer and the security engineer can put into your shoes. Both roles are essential for the success and you need to find a way how to collaborate better. This is basically, it has to be done because everybody is contributing and if you are able to cooperate better, the products and services will be good and secure. So basically both profiles will accomplish their job. What can actually help is starting to speak with the same language and knowledge sharing in both directions. So basically security people sharing knowledge with developers and developers sharing more information about the application, context, and so on. And especially this will be extremely useful when incidents starts to happen and you will see that the collaboration is much, much, much easier. I'm also aware that the security engineers have this kind of, we are considered as NACs, that basically we understand that security, that we come, that hey, the security thing, the security issue has to be fixed. And we are aware of the fact that you have, your security is a low top bottom of the your priorities because you need to deliver that feature that product owner asked and yesterday was late. You have a critical bug which you need to fix to meet the sprint deadlines. But there is always something happening and in most cases we are having the same in security teams. Apart from that, we also have to care about the security. We should cooperate together and not fight. It's important that you deliver fast, but also a secure application. Some examples of better collaboration. In many cases, with my colleagues, we were thinking how we could actually help our developers. And in many cases, we realized that the security, that the developers in other teams were afraid to ask questions. And we are very happy to help you. When you come with us that, hey, we need a security review of this application, it is very easy to catch and spot mistakes in the design phase than to deal with them once the application is in the production. There are a lot of work and potential issues coming once the application is in the production. We are also happy to give you advice on any security topics you might have. Security questions you might have. It doesn't have to be completely related to applications. If you do not know how to protect against this threat or how to do properly this, just go and ask your security engineer. We are also willing to do anything to tear barriers down. This is basically meant in a way that we are really willing to do anything to help you because with you delivering a proper job, we have less work to do. So there is a huge motivation from our side to actually try to help you and find ways and bridges how to collaborate better. Last but not least, is that we are also very happy to listen about your application, give us as much context as you can. And one of the reasons for this is that, for example, when some of my colleagues were doing pen testing, the more they prepared and spent time with developers, the better examples they got, more documentation, better they understand the whole application logic. And they actually provided a very nice feedback to developers. And did an awesome job when it comes to properly locating vulnerabilities, focusing on trying to basically hack the application logic, and they were able to get very nice results as an example of the communication. incidents are happened, they are happening, and they will happen. And properly handling incidents is not the rocket science. However, there are certain things that needs to be done properly. If you are not confident enough and you do not know what to do, then do not do anything. Let the incident just happen and just wait for the security people to act. Because we need to gather evidence for potential legal cases, and things like properly shutting down the machine, taking the snapshot, or doing the memory dump is very important, because if you just shut down the machine without one of these things, then we are not able to analyze what happened, how it happened, how we were attacked, how the breach happened, and so on. As well as we need the data for potential legal cases. You are also a very valuable member in the incident dealing, incident solving squad, because your context of the application and data is actually very, very important for us, because we as a security people do not have always the full context of your application. And if your application got compromised, please do not leave, stay part of the squad, and don't leave your security engineer inside, because as I said, it is very, very important that you actually help, because we might have questions, and those questions might be answered by you in 30 seconds, and we might be, otherwise we might be looking for answers for hours, and with 72-hour deadline for GDPR is actually any minute saved actually counts. So now comes the kind of bigger part. It's about how to fix low-hanging fruit, and now giving some specific examples. Basically, low-hanging fruit is in many cases many people do not consider it to be important, but actually, with the correct situation and in a proper situation, it actually can become a ticking bomb. So one of the examples are bad password management. For example, you are storing your passwords in plaintext, in Git repositories, or in source code. Another issue is the wrong use of cryptography. Incorrect permissions and access rights. You might write the most secure code on the planet, but if the data you are processing is publicly stored and publicly accessible, basically you have a big problem. So do we. Another issue similar to this are that a lot of people actually are giving too broad permissions, and on resources they do not necessarily actually have. And last but not least is the inappropriate use of encryption, which is also very common. When it comes to bad password management, never ever store secrets in plain text. This is the most basic, most recommended, yet most underestimated thing when dealing with passwords, tokens, or secrets. I would like to thank you, all developers who stick to password management best practices, and those that don't, I think that you can do better. And if you have doubts or if you're not sure, just go and talk to your security engineer. He will gladly help you and guide you. Because if you do not like this, if you do not properly handle passwords in combination with other issues, it can end up like this, which basically you have a bug in your code and you might expose passwords. And with that, you are actually having more work, because not only you have to fix the problem, but you also have to manage the process and force users to change their passwords. Or like this, where security people see this as a problem, some people see this as a feature. And just so you realize how stupid this is, then there is a double facepalm. So please, never store secrets in the plain text. How can you actually do it? Use a proper hashing function and techniques. There are actually algorithms like bcrypt, scrypt, or argon2. They are well tested, and they are all available in the popular Python paslib library. Always try to have a proper password policy in mind. The length of the password should be of should be appropriate given the importance of the application, but the password should always contain uppercase letters, lowercase letters, numbers, and special characters. Some of the services which I will mention in next slides also support rotating password, and password should also be rotated at least once in a while. When storing a secret, always use salt. Salt is basically a way which you are adding to the, which is basically a publicly known random unique string that makes actually decrypting the, and breaking the passwords much harder for the attackers. In addition to salt, there is also the concept of pepper. Pepper is basically opposite of salt, which is basically a secret value, which is added before hashing, and this makes the password far more complicated, decrypting password far more complicating, and without this value, the basically attacker cannot do it so easily. Plus, if your users have a weak historical, if your users have a weak passwords for historical reasons, then adopting a pepper might be actually a good mitigation technique, because you are actually also protecting users by because they are using weak passwords. And if always in doubt, always follow the Open Web Application Security Project guidelines on these topics. So some of the mitigations. So for detecting these problems, you can actually, there are two most basic tools would be Bandit and Git Secrets. Bandit is basically a project which I will be introducing later in slides, so I will skip it for now. Git Secrets is a project written by Amazon, and the idea here is that before committing to the repository, it will try to locate for secrets by using several algorithms. For storage options, there is a project called Vault from HashiCorp, which is a pretty solid one, and we recommend to use it if you can. If you do not want to run another service than Google, and you are running in Google Cloud is offering a managed offering of HashiCorp Vault. Then you have services like AWS Secrets Manager, which is basically a service from Amazon that actually that was created very recently, and it supports you generating passwords, rotating, and keeping them safe. If you need to deal with different secrets like passwords, there is a far more general AWS key management service, which basically allows you to gives you a way how to manage secret keys. And Google equivalent would be Google Cloud KMS. The idea behind the service is that if you need to do anything with a secret, like storing it safely, or rotating it, then this service is also for you. When it comes to your secrets on your workstations, always I always recommend using some kind of KeePass or some other password management application. And if you are working quite a lot with AWS, then service called application called AWS Vault can actually help you, because it will use the short token service and temporary credentials when you are manipulating with the AWS APIs. Okay, let's move to incorrect permissions and access rights. These are very common issues. Imagine that you are setting wrong permissions on files, directories, databases, or buckets which store sensitive data, or you are opening the instances or your services to the internet. Imagine that you are having your web services running inside the cloud, and you keep port 22, which is SSH, open to the internet. You will get attacked instantly. We run a test inside the security team, and Amazon has this service called Amazon Elastic MapReduce, which is basically spawning instances to do compute jobs, and we kept it open for the internet. And 1 minute after the launch, the instance was already compromised. So keep this in mind, that attackers are not sleeping. They are doing everything they can to gain access to resources. Some of the services which actually can help are AWS Trusted Advisor, which basically tries to warn you about these kind of security groups or public buckets. AWS Guard Duty, which is basically monitoring, let's say that your instance is a part of a botnet, or some crypto miner is mining and doing malicious stuff on the network, it will warn you. AWS Config is a way how you can enforce certain rules. So for example, imagine that you want to open security groups to everywhere, and you can actually forbid it by using AWS Config. AWS Inspector is giving you overview of overall security inside Amazon. For Google Cloud, Google Cloud Security Command Center is basically a combination of all these tools, and through it you can actually see what's the overall security of your cloud instances and services inside the Google Cloud. One of the interesting projects I quite like, also written in Python, is Cloud Custodian. Basically, Cloud Custodian is a rule engine for the cloud. What it does is that basically it allows you to define policies written in YAML for querying, filtering, and taking actions on resources. With it, you can do things like removing the security. Let's say that you put a very open ingress rule to a security group. You can have a cloud custodian remove it for you. Or if the buckets have a public ACLs, basically they can roll it back. Some of the examples. So basically, this is the S3 bucket ACL policy removal. So basically, we are specifying type of the event, which is basically CloudTrail is a service for getting events, which we are interested in create bucket, source is S3, and filter is granting ACLs, and action, if there is a public ACL, then basically we will remove it and we will only apply it to these grantees, and then a notify action will be done, which will basically send out an email or a notification for people that, hey, we changed this and we removed this. Another such example is removal of OpenSSH to the internet ingress rule, where again we are using CloudTrail as event source. We are filtering on specific rules, so we are basically interested in port 22 and on 0.0.0/0, and the same variant for IPv6. And what we will do is that basically we will remove the permission from the security group, and we will also send out the notification to the appropriate users. Okay. Another topic is lack of use of encryption. Basically, it's 2019 and encryption is a standard, it should be everywhere. Modern processors have a hardware acceleration, so basically it is not a performance problem anymore. The encryption should be deployed between the end users and your service. TLS is for this. The certificate management issues, we were a problem in the past, but with Let's Encrypt and ACME protocol, this is a solved problem. And if you are using Amazon or Google, then they have their own version of Let's Encrypt. Let's put it that way. They have Amazon ACM and Google has something with certificates. Also, when it comes to your workstation, always encrypt your drives. You are protecting your data, which is the most important thing you have on your laptop. And you won't even feel the penalty for performance because the modern CPUs have hardware acceleration for this. And enabling encryption in your workstation or operating system of choice is normally a few clicks away. And I would also like to thank to people who are using encryption between internal communication between their services. If you are using a low-level encryption and you need to use it, then always make sure that you are using the proper and correct security primitives. It is very easy to get this wrong, and you can actually leak the data. And this actually leads to a false sense of security. We also recommend to use higher level APIs function libraries like cryptography. So unless you have to use crypto for specific reasons, I mean low level crypto for specific reasons, always try to use the libraries with higher level APIs and rely on the same defaults that are in those libraries. When it comes to inventing your own cryptography, never ever do this, because you will be only creating a lot of work for you and as well as security people. Another section is code and dependency vulnerabilities. There is a tool called Bandit. Basically, Bandit is a security linter for Python. It originated in OpenStack security team. Bandit works by statically analyzing your code. It basically builds the abstract syntax tree, and then it parses the AST and applies the proper plugins to the AST nodes. It can find common errors, for example, hard-coded passwords. If you are forcing or specifying certificate TLS cipher configuration, basically it can warn you about the bad one. If you are using unmaintained crypto libraries, it can warn you. It can also warn you about the usage of about the raw SQL usage, spot out things like cross-site scripting, SQL injections, or if you are executing commands, it can show you, it can warn you that hey, this execution is potentially dangerous. However, with all the static analysis. With the potential, you are getting a lot of false positives. It is very easy to integrate into your continuous integration pipeline. Here are some examples regarding what it can do. When it comes to dependency vulnerabilities, there are a lot of services like GitHub, Snyk, and PyApio, and normally for public projects, these are free. And some additional tools you can use is OWASP dependency check and safety, which is also for Python dependencies. So to summarize, GDPR changed how we look at the security privacy. Mutual understanding is really important. Low-hanging fruit issues should be fixed and should not be underestimated. Adopt some tools in your Python projects and talk to security engineers and be secure. And I would like to thank these people. And if there are any questions, I will answer them after the talk because the time's up. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you.